Yeah, I mean, this is a one.
Whoever would like to join, the lunch will take place in Student Center Room 324 on October 28th from 12 to 1:30. So if you could, I'm going to send this around, your name, ID number, and if you have any dietary restrictions. Only sign up if you are able to attend. Thank you.
I would just like to say thank you to all the FGA students and members that helped out with the debate party. I'd like to thank the e-board as well for all of the efforts.
I also have an announcement that, as all of you know, I'm conducting interviews for as director of policy and procedure. I met with all of them and they put their assessments and followed all the protocols necessary to obtaining the position. Out of the three candidates, I felt that one person stood out among the rest. That person was Senator Najjar. So I am looking to appoint her as the director of P&P but I would like any questions to be addressed at this time before I accept any motions. Any questions? Would like someone like to entertain a motion to Senator King?
I move to appoint Senator Najera to the Director of Policy and Procedures.
Senator Jane?
Aye.
Any discussion on the matter? Objection? Hearing none, motion passed. So, any other announcements? So moving on, we could, if someone entertained a motion to ratify the meeting minutes from the October 7th meeting. Senator Carton?
So moved.
Any discussion? Any objections? Order of business is Vice Provost Marius Sakala, and he will be talking to us about personnel information.
Hello, everybody. It's great to see you. I have to admit that this is my first experience attending project meetings, and it's great to see so many people that are interested in running this place. So I come from the College of Education, and I was there for 14 years. But since July 1st of this year, I became the Vice Provost for Academic Planning, and you may know, those of you who have been on SGA for a while, you may have worked with Teresa LaGrange. Does the name ring a bell? Okay. Well, I'm the new Teresa. For people who have known her, I have to introduce myself in my new capacity using that particular label. And Teresa spent about a year or two, a year and a half, I think, developing this searchable database. And through involvement from SGA, the President's Office, the Vice Provost, sorry, the Provost's Office, Faculty Senate, this is the end product. And I think it's comparable to Rate My Professors, or Professor, I don't know, it's universal.com. And I'll tell you why it's better. What you see is represented only by quantitative data. So you know that the student evaluation forms have room for comments. Those are the qualitative pieces, but those are not captured by this database. So we will distribute the web address to all of the students on campus so that they can use it whenever they want to. It could be used wherever in the world. But one, this is the landing page. So once you get there, we have some navigation items across the top. I apologize that the font size is pretty small, but I hope I can, yeah. So across the top, we have the home button, then results by subject, which if you click on that, it takes you to the same page as this one, search by subject. Results by instructor, if you click on that, it takes you to the same page as this item does, search by instructor. And then you have about, which is the same as you see here. And this is really just a snippet of what the information on that particular page. For more information, you can click there. And it gives you some detail on the methodology. And two things to keep in mind. Out of all of the student evaluations selected for fall of 15 and spring of 16, through a vote on the faculty side and through conversations with the SGA and the provost office, the two criteria that we all agreed on are that we will include in this database only classes where there are at least 5 students responded and 30% response rate for the class. And that's captured here as well. If you don't see a class or an instructor here, it doesn't mean that there's no track record of your evaluations of that class. It means that information is housed in the department that offers the class. And if you want to check in with the department to find out, I don't know if that has happened before, but that's one option that you have. Back to the home page. Continuing our navigation menu across the top, contact. There's the 5050 phone number listed here. And if you want to log in, you can do that by clicking on this button. go here. So let's do a search by subject. And this is a safety mechanism. So like I said, this website could be accessed from wherever in the world, but it's intended to be used for internal purposes to make sure that that's the case. Once you want to do a search by subject or by instructor, you have to use your CSU credentials. And I'll let me put in mine. So it's your regular CSU ID and password that you use for Blackboard or for any other to access campus and everything else. And like I said, we only have data up until now for two semesters, fall of last year and spring of this year. So you have to make a choice there. And then this drop-down menu becomes active once you made a choice in terms of the semester. And here you have a listing of all the courses with their respective prefix. So do we have any preferred department to look at?
Urban studies?
And I checked with the president, and he would like us to have, at any given time, once we build up the database to that level, he'd like us to have 3 years worth of data. So we're still collecting four more semesters. And then as we go into the fifth semester, so the beginning of the fourth year, we archive the fall 15, and we show you 3 years worth of data. So it'll be on a rolling basis, a 3 years worth of data. So this web page, this database has two layers. This is the first one. So what you get here, and you can filter in ascending order or descending order, if that matters to you. Section number again, ascending or descending, and you can change. You can list them in alphabetical order or not. So the first layer that you get to see is really an overview of all of the courses offered in spring of 16 by Urban Studies. So you get to see the prefix, the course number, the title, if it's lecture or seminar or whatever other variation we may have. Section number, instructor name, obviously everything will be spring 16 because that's the choice we made. And then we have the instructor mean on a 5-point Likert scale, and the course mean also out of 5 points. And what's nice is if you place your cursor over any of these cells or columns, that whole line or row gets. And there's a reason for that, because if you want to get to the deeper level of analysis, you can click on it. And by, do we have a preference? The gentleman who recommended Urban Studies, do you have a course number in mind?
No, can we do that James Wiles, The Natural History of Cleveland, the first one?
The first one?
The first Natural History of Cleveland, that's like 8 now.
Oh, this one.
Yeah, thank you.
So, this is the deeper dive. Here you have the mean and the instructor mean and the course mean on a bar so that you can see out of 5. And initially, we didn't have that, but it's sometimes easier to see what it means to be out of 5. And by the time you get to the second page, you may forget that this is out of 5 as opposed to out of 4. Because there is also, we also have a component that has a 4-point Likert scale. And then here you see how many students were in class. Invited 23, 8 out of them responded. So the response ratio is 35%, which meets one of the criteria that I mentioned. It has to be over 30% response rate, and at least 5 students. And here you have, so this instructor is pretty good, according to the students that took his class in this game. 6 of them rated him excellent, 2 above average, none average below, which leads to an overall rating of 4.75 out of 5. And here, not to bore you, you have all the items on the survey that you get at the beginning of the class. So these, all of these items relate to the instructor, and you can see the breakdown by item. And then further down, you have all the items related to the course. See, that's, if you notice here, this, the course level information is on a 4-point Likert scale. And that's something that we have to correct. The provost talked to the faculty senate about trying to reach an agreement on how the two could be more in sync. Because if you see 3.75 here and you miss that, you're used to 5 points here. All of a sudden, this looks a lot worse than here. So we have to correct that. And again, what's missing is the set of comments that you write. Any questions that you might have? Yes.
Why only a few semesters as opposed to just, you know, from now on, including all semesters?
Well, it'll be from now on, all semesters will be included.
Okay, I thought you said it was a rolling basis and there would only be a few shown.
Well, it may be a matter of managing the database. I don't know, I'm not an IS person. The president suggested 3 years, we could extend it to 5. And in the end, the data would be archived. So you could send in a request to see. Though, in all fairness, if you want to see something that's 7 years old,
right,
things change.
Right.
So, going back 3 years might be more relevant than waiting beyond that. Yes.
Is there any way to see the aggregate data for the last 3 years, or maybe in 3 years that will be the case?
Per department, per class,
per
whole university,
I would say per professor.
College. Yeah, that's something that we only have 2 semesters now, so I'm collecting information about what else we could add to this. One suggestion that I got in addition to yours. Was that we could identify web-based courses versus face-to-face courses or hybrid, because web-based courses tend to have not only a higher attrition rate, meaning that a lot of students drop out because it's not for them or whatever the case may be, but also the response rate drops from 70% face-to-face to 40% online. If you take an online class and you're asked to complete the survey online, less than half of the students. This is a national study. So that's something that we'll add. I would suggest whatever suggestion, whatever recommendations you have, filter them through your SGA president so that we can centralize all the information that you want us to include, so that in the course of the first year of using this database, we can think of what works, what doesn't, and what other features we want to add.
Are these going to be anonymous results, or will the students be?
No, the student evaluations are. We don't know.
Right.
So it's all anonymous.
Thank you.
And there was another suggestion. I have it in an email somewhere. They will come back to me. So. In the future, if you want me to come back and update you on, oh, yes, came back to me. I asked ISNT to build in some traffic monitoring features so that we can get a better idea over the courses of a semester or maybe the entire year if this website is used primarily for students to look at the first level, or if the majority of the users get to this level, because that has implications on how useful this database is. And it may mean that we have to publicize the website more and in more effective ways. And as you start using it, in case you have suggestions about, I don't like this, I don't know what that means, or what that means. Yes.
How does the faculty feel about being ranked?
They're not ranked.
Not ranked, but they're being
rated.
Yeah,
I think that's why I preceded all of this by saying that I came in at the tail end of the process. We had to have faculty senate involvement all throughout this process, and everything that you see was approved by the faculty senate president and the university faculty affairs committee, so they know. I mean, the representatives of the faculty know that this is in place. I emailed the link to the website to the deans, associate deans, and chairs to send it to the faculty. Anytime you are evaluated and the results of the evaluation are made public, there's a bit of uncertainty about how this would be used. But as I was telling your president earlier, whenever we have something like this, we can use it to improve performance. And it would have to be the department chair, and I used to be one, sitting down with a faculty member that seems to have a track record of negative feedback from students, to see how he or she, as chair, could help. So the assumption is not to use this as a punishment, but to raise awareness in how I do as an instructor in the classroom. What is it that my students think of my performance? And what do I do about that? So if we use it as formative assessment, that would be good for all involved.
You briefly mentioned publicizing this to students. Do you know yet how you're going to go about that?
Through you all, and then I think Boyd would facilitate the distribution directly to all of the students.
Should I write the URL?
I'll send it.
Any other questions?
If you could just give everyone like a brief, very brief description of your position and what it entails and how we can be helpful in your case and how we can reach out to you as student representatives.
All right, so my job, it's so much on my plate that I have to think of where do I start. It doesn't really matter because everything is equally important. So my office is the provost, who is the chief academic officer, so he's responsible for the entire academic side of the house. He has three vice provosts. One is in charge of faculty affairs, so all faculty contracts, hiring, promotion, all of that is handled by him. We have a vice provost that is in charge of all the undergraduate programs. And I'm the third in charge of academic planning. And in that capacity, I oversee the process of strategic planning for the entire university and also boiled down to the level of the different colleges. Program review, accreditation, assessment, institutional research, space management, and then I also have other projects such as textbook cost reduction, all the initiatives associated with that, so a lot more. So whatever comes up in the course of an academic year. So think of my office as helping move this university along through strategic planning. And we serve all constituents. You are probably the key constituent. So as you go to classes, as you engage in learning on campus or off campus, and as you entertain employment prospects based on your qualifications from CSU, if in the process of doing all of that you think you wish you had this or that, or this could be improved, this could be expanded, this could be dropped, anything that would speak to that, I would be able to formulate in terms of maybe we have to change a policy, maybe we have to change a procedure, maybe we have to communicate that. Anything that would inform us in our decision making. Thank you all, and best of luck. Thank you.
One director this week, and that is for the position of marketing and social media. His name is Michael Novoslowski. He could not be here today. He is working TEDx. If you guys all know Mike, if you've seen the Cleveland State Snapchat stories, that's Mike. So he has a breadth of information as far as marketing. We're lucky to have him on the team. The second thing that I will speak on is committee chairmanship. And in regards to the Constitution, I meant to appoint committee chairpersons. Instead of waiting back from the committees to meet first, I'm going to appoint that person, and that person is going to be responsible for convening those committees. The ones that are, so finance is Treasurer Singh, that's already been appointed and ratified. Investigation legislation, Speaker Kangan. The Committee of Public Relations would be Director Noslowski. Student Appointments Board, otherwise known as SAB, would be Secretary Gresh. The new one here is the Committee on Diversity, and that is Senator Najib. The Community Outreach Committee, that's Director Jane. The Committee on Public Policy is going to be chaired by Senator C, co-chaired by Vice President Wilson. United Student Organizations is also chaired by Vice President Wilson. SARB is going to be chaired by Speaker Kangan. The Ad Hoc Multi-Faith Committee will be now Director Najjar. And then Ad Hoc Academic Affairs Committee, Senator Martin. And so those people are responsible for convening those committees. And then once you have your first meeting, you can have a conversation about co-chairing those committees, potentially moving chairpersons depending on the person's availability and how they're working with the group. So we can have that conversation. Doesn't need to go through ratification, but if anyone has any questions,
okay. Can you speak on the other positions, why they weren't appointed to director?
Right, so the other positions that we didn't appoint Director of Governmental Affairs, Director of Student Affairs, or Director of Academic Affairs, for a couple of reasons. I think in the past, the MO has been, well, those positions are there, we need to fill them. And if you look at it holistically, and you consider it at a deeper level, maybe that's not the best way to proceed. And I'll speak to each individual position just so I can, you know, provide transparency. For the Director of Governmental Relations, we felt that based on our e-board and what we had, we have the capability so that we can address anything that pertains to governmental relations and public policy. And how do we make decisions like that? You have to be considerate of the fact that those director positions are student leadership scholarships. And that money actually comes from student dollars, directly from student dollars, comes out of the general fee. Our e-board, that all of those scholarships come from the general fee. So for us to just say, well, those positions are there, we need to fill them for the sake of filling them, is irresponsible. So we wanted to take a deeper look at it. With respect to the other positions, we simply just did not have enough candidates to fill those positions. I think that the magic number when you're interviewing for a position is at least 3 qualified individuals, and we just simply didn't meet that number. So I didn't feel comfortable putting someone in that position when there wasn't a large enough candidate pool. And that's a pretty standard practice across human relations in any organization.
So will you be reopening these applications?
Yeah, for sure. And then we'll continue to make decisions as we move along. You know, like right now, like I said, we feel like based on my experience and Vice President Wilson's experience with the government, that we're capable of handling something like that. You know, as we move on, I think that we're going to find that those other positions are going to need to be filled. Right now, we're still in the formative phases, so we're able to carry that kind of load. But moving forward, you know, we're going to have to look at it as it goes, so.
Any other questions?
One more thing. Sorry. I'll be quick. So
We're still working on the student council diversity. If you can, you know, ask your friends if that's something they're interested in. I reached out to student organizations. We're going to have a meeting on October 28th, which is next Friday. Let me know if that's something that's of interest to anyone. We met with the director of sustainability for CSU. This is a new position. So we're talking about green, we're talking about waste and energy. How do we make this a sustainable campus? And I know that in the past there's been a lot of senator projects that were focused on this. So if anyone is interested, please reach out to me and I'll put you in contact with the director of sustainability. In the past we've had senators put in recycling cans at Fenn, things of that nature, recycling bins. I already said that. Earth Day, that was a senator project, so we haven't had that for about 2 years. We even had a senator who wanted to put, what are those called? Solar panels on Rhodes Tower. You know, we didn't have the funding for that, but maybe in the future. So this Sunday, it's called Stick or Treat. It's the first, like, scrimmage lacrosse game. And then, that's going to be at noon this Sunday, and then after that, student organization is going to be handing out candy. So if anyone is interested in doing that for student government, let us know. You know, hand out candy to kids. They're going to have like a little thing where people are coming to Prenzler Field to hand out candy. There's a can drive. Lift Up Bikes is hosting a can drive, and it's like a competition between student organizations. Each can you get is awarded a point for that organization. So if anyone wants to spearhead that, let me know. And then, you know, we'll continue to collect cans in the office, and then where Lift Up Bikes meets. Like the votes, we had a great attendance at our last two events, the registration drive. I don't believe we've met since then. We had about 400 people attend the event, and they were able to figure out where they were registered, who they could vote for. And then we had about almost 100 people actually register to vote. So, you know, kudos to everyone that was there. We've got a ton of people who are going to be engaged in the voting process that otherwise wouldn't have been. And then the bait watch party, although we had some technical difficulties and the sound wasn't working like we'd like to have had, we still had about 100 to 150 people there. I've never seen Chili's like that, so that was awesome to have an event like that. So then the culmination of these events will end on the 4th of November. We're going to call that event Stroll to the Pole. So what we'll do as an organization, in concert with the other co-sponsors of this Bike the Vote campaign, is to actually walk down to the Board of Elections on East 30th in Euclid and early vote. So more information to come on what that will look like. And then for the retreat tomorrow, this is my last day. So we're going to be volunteering at Fairhope Partners. It's an adult family caregiving center. You know, they give assistance to people who are recently homeless. They teach families how to, you know, take care of elderly, their elderly family members. So it's an opportunity for us to come together to do public service, because that's what this office is all about, is us doing public service for this university. So let's practice that, you know, in the community and show that we're capable of that. So the two things that they want us to do are paint the inside of the doors, inside the facility. So if you're interested in that, make sure you're bringing clothes that you don't mind getting paint on. You won't necessarily get paint on, but it's possible. And they also want us to take care of the outside grounds. So if you want to do that, make sure you wear like boots and warm clothes. We're going to need a distribution of people. So if you want to, we're going to bus people, carpool. If you want to do that, we're going to meet at 8 o'clock in the urban atrium. They're going to have a breakfast there, and then we'll move from there to Fairhill Partners. And then if you just want to meet at the actual project site, we're meeting at 9 a.m. So look in the email that I sent out, and you can just meet us there. That's all I've got. Thank you.
All right, how's everybody doing?
Good.
So I'm just going to go over a few things about how you guys can use it. So one of the things that I've discovered is that when you sign out, it's like there's no way. So I just opened up a new. So you guys probably can't see everything that I see, but you know, I'll just go through what the SGA page looks like and all the things that you guys can see. So SGA is always over here on the left side right there, or you know, since you guys are all members, it's up here. So the first thing is our home page. That's where you can see like the feed, so any new files that go up, you can see it there. Probably the things that you guys care about most is the office hours timesheet. It's almost always going to be right there, or it's under forms. And any form, anywhere on OrgSync, you can always just search it at the top and it'll come up. So if you just search like office hours, it'll come up in there somewhere. Next we have the people tab. Everybody's on here. I put everybody's title on, so if you don't know somebody's title, you can go here and look. Hopefully you guys are going on your own profile and putting in your email, and I know I have my phone number on here, so if you guys want to put your phone number on here too, then people can text you also. So there's my phone number. You can download your own little roster on here. Right here. It'll open up as an Excel file. Let's see. Events tab, so I usually put events on here, so I'll be putting that, what's it called, walk to?
Scroll through polls.
That'll go on here soon. If you guys have any events that you guys are doing and you want me to put them on there, just let me know. That's one way that I can reach out to people. So files, I'm working on, you know, cleaning this up a little bit, because as you can see, there's just a bunch of folders and stuff here. So if you're looking for a file, best thing to do, just search it. Forms, if you guys want to do any kind of, form for an event, you know, get feedback, stuff like that, we can set one up and create one here, but this is where all like our applications are, office hours, time sheets, stuff like that. News, I thought that we could send out an all school email this way, I guess we can't, but we can. This is a way that I can still send out, and anybody else can send out news posts to just us and SGA. And then if you guys want, I can forward it to Dan, and Dan can send it out to the whole school. It has to be pretty important if we're going to do that, but that's just one thing we can do.
How do we edit our profile?
Go up to the here? One thing I forgot to mention is that your address is on here, you put it in here. So if you guys want to take off your address, you might want to do that. Yeah, like I can go in and see if I'm there. Yeah. A lot of this other stuff we don't really use, but if you guys are interested in using it, we can kind of get that going. Messaging we do kind of use, I've used it before. Messaging really just means email. So if you want to send an email to everyone on SGA and you don't actually have everyone's email, you can do it in here. If you go to lists, I can also create a group. So if I just want to send it to senders, I can do that here. Or I can do all organization members. Also, people like Dan are in here. So try to remove Dan before you send. So we have polls. That's what we use for what kind of sandwiches you guys want tomorrow. Hopefully everybody did that. Let's see what else. I think that's an administrative thing. To-dos. We've never really used this yet, but for committees, you might want to start using this. You can create a little to-do list for all the committee members in your organization. So, you know, say you want Senator May
actually probably is our website. You guys probably didn't know that we have a OrgSync website. It could probably look better. I'm not really into web design. So if anybody wants to help me out with this, I'm looking to do you guys a PR committee maybe. But, you know, this is where we can put other stuff on here that, you know, you normally can't do on an OrgSync page. So, but this has some pictures on here, contact page, stuff like that. And then if you guys remember our website from last year, you know, I can customize like this to look like that. But I mean, this is good for now. I think that's all that I really want to talk about. Just a little bit of marketing stuff that I can do. You know, we have a TV outside the office that I can put like PowerPoints and stuff on. I know Dan told me that if you guys have any major things, I can send something to him and get it on those like TVs that are flipped upwards that are all over the student center. So that's just one more thing. You know, if you guys are having anything or anything in there. No.
Any other questions for Director Stephen?
That's all I got.
Took in to account all of the committees that you guys are like lining up. So we did all that. Everybody's on at least one SGA and one university committee. I'm going to be explaining more of that at the retreat tomorrow, so it won't take too much time. Just be making sure that you guys are actually looking at your emails, going more than if you're getting a random email from like someone at CSU, it's probably about your university committee, so make sure you guys are definitely looking. And then I'll just go into it a lot more detail tomorrow.
Mm-hmm. Were those motions and seconded?
Yeah,
they
definitely were.
Any discussion? Yeah. Any discussion on that? Senator?
Will you have any notes on that? Because I'm not able to make it tomorrow.
If you have any questions about anything, you can come and see me in the office. Because I have to go to a lot of those community meetings. So I can like give you advice on that. All right.
I know someone mentioned it in Senator training. Cheat sheet together of all the things we discussed, and so we're hoping to have that for the retreat tomorrow. So the funding process and committees will all be hopefully shed light on. Any other questions? Okay, let's move on to Senator Pichetti, the Senator update.
I'll explain to what you have in front of you in just a moment. But I kept making announcements for probably the past couple Senate meetings right now about this one night program. And essentially I was asked, you know, why did you do one last week for the previous Senate meeting?
I wanted to kind of put together something a little bit more substantial tonight,
just so you guys have an idea what this might look like after this so far. So, if you guys don't know me, my name is David Pachetti. I'm a College of Liberal Arts Social Science graduate senator. And I've been working with many, actually some of you, actually, and a whole group of folks now that have been working on this issue on campus. So I wanted to present to you that today. So I just want to go over just a couple of things. I'm going to make this brief, probably as brief as I can, but there's some good stuff in here, so we're going to get to it. So how is Cleveland State combating issues of sexual violence? And also, I'm going to give you the update for one night. And also, I don't want to give you another lecture because that would be very boring. So I know you guys have lots of classes, so I'm not going to try to do that. Prevention services on campus. So we all know what prevention is. You know, if, say you're out in the middle of Euclid Avenue and you see a bus heading for you, like the Health Line. You want to dodge out of the way so you prevent death. Just as sexual violence prevention, there is precautionary steps that you can take to reduce the risk of those types of things. That's going to be given through peer education as of right now. Peer education is essentially it was actually a piloted program in Kent, Ohio, Kent College, and what they pretty much tried to do was say, okay, how are we going to make this more accessible to students? So what they tried to do and what they have figured out is that if you educate the students to educate other students, you're essentially removing the middleman of a lot of things like funding and a lot of more difficult trainings that you usually cannot obtain. So through peer education support, that's been one of the biggest things. And if you, after you go through peer education support, you can become a catalyst bystander. And what a catalyst bystander is somebody who is being an active bystander. You know, there's the whole idea of being an inactive bystander. You know, when you see something going on in the street, you know, just walking past it and not taking another glance at it, and kind of just saying it's not my business. But being a catalyst bystander is somebody who's actively involved in that. For any of you who like statistics, I put a few up here. These don't relate to Cleveland State whatsoever. I just got them off of the RAIN website, which is really great. They have really great statistics on any type of information like this. 90% of those who are sexually assaulted in the United States are female. Among undergraduate students, almost a quarter of them are almost a quarter of females, and 5.4% of males experience rape or sexual assault through physical force, violence, or incapacitation. And only 20% of female student victims age 18 to 24 report to law enforcement. So that means approximately 80% or so don't choose to report it. Cleveland State's position. So how prevalent is it on this campus? We don't know, because a lot of it, we're in this transition phase of becoming less of a commuter school and more of sort of a residential school. We put that new building down by East 17th and Euclid, the edge. That's getting built right now. We're having more residential facilities now. The Cleveland State Campus Police and Sexual Violence Response Guide, that's what you have in front of you. They provided that to kind of give more information about, and it's all good information, about how you can, what steps to take, just in case if you know somebody that's going through this. And then there is the HYPE team on campus. The HYPE team stands for Helping You Through Peer Education, and that's the peer educating support team in campus, Cleveland State. There's over 60 members so far who have gone through the Catalyst Bystander training, which is excellent, and then we're hoping to get more as well. So just for those new senators now, this is really great because this shows a chart of when I became a senator last year, and when I was trying to figure out my way through Cleveland State, I noticed that it was really helpful if I got some charts on people's position in relation to the school. So the person that has been working with me very much so is the director or one of the help the main. Director of the HYPE team, which is Denise. She is in the Health and Wellness Services at Cleveland State University,
And we can see that as far as like one night is concerned, you know, we only took up one of these boxes right here. So the hike team tries to get all of this going on. So, you know, we're talking suicide prevention, there's alcohol over there, violence prevention, catalyst bystander training, as you can see. And like, oh, this is just one, this is just only one thing out of the whole possible things that the hike team is trying to do. So we had the one night, it was, we had about, I'm not exactly sure how many of the exact number it was, but we definitely filled it, probably I'd say 3/4 almost, but probably a little bit more than 3/4 full in the auditorium and main classroom. What one night was a theater troupe from New York City called Equology, that's these four folks right here. They put on a play about sexual violence prevention and all of that. And that's also Denise, she's the leader of the hike team as well. We had the privilege of meeting them and hanging out with them for a little while, so I was really glad I got to do that as well. Just shows you some of the tabling that was going on. There was a lot of collaborative efforts. I know I can name a few senators here who have been helping me with this, like Rashida Najib and Gabby Spendros as well. And I know Talithia, you came to the play as well as Mel Canova as well. So thank you guys for showing your support. If I didn't name anybody who wasn't there, I probably didn't see you or I forgot either way. But definitely I think it was a successful event. The organizations that we had that was all collaborating was all on the board, as you can see, a bunch of people, including the Hike Team Campus Activities Board, Student Counseling Center, Interfraternity Council, that was good to see them as well. And remember, because of that, teamwork makes the dream work. So before I let you go, and I just wanted to give you three basic life skills that you can use in any of these situations. They are the 3 Ds of prevention. It doesn't matter what type of situation is going on, whether that's sexual violence prevention or mental health psychosis, or also included in there is like suicide as well. People who are thinking about or undergoing that, and also violence. These are very serious issues, but these are the 3 Ds that they say to use. So the first one, and probably the most scary thing to do, is direct approach. For example, if you see, I was thinking of this the other day, this would probably be the easiest way to explain this. If you see somebody put something in somebody's drink, that's a very visual thing. So somebody who is gonna be going to the direct approach use would go up to them and ask them about it, as you very well may imagine that to go over. So it takes a very special person to do that. Not everybody likes it. So that's why there's 2 other ones. Distract is, you know, doing something more proactive in a sense where you're going in different directions. So, you know, maybe spilling a drink on them, or falling in front of them, or, you know, especially this is good if you know the person who was the victim of somebody putting the substance in the glass. You can go up to them and say, hey, you know, let's go over here, you know, you can distract that way. And then the last is delegation. This is good for people who don't know the person that's having this happen to them, calling 911, emergency services, or advising them, or telling a student advisor or a teacher or something that anything is going on. What I wanted to give you was, in front of you though, you have the Cleveland Police recommendation, or the Cleveland State Police recommendations for sexual violence prevention. And I thought I'd just mention this to you guys, just so you had it. Again, all very good information. And thank you for your time.
Happening like every college campus across the nation. It's an issue that is relevant at the table right now, at the policy level, at the community level. So what you're doing is very admirable.
senators, you can learn from Daniel Pichetti. He's been a leader, and the fact that he's taken this issue in his own hands is awesome, and that's the kind of work we want to see, so really thank you.
Thank you. Anybody who ever wants to get involved with any of those issues that we saw on the board today, I'll send you Denise's way. She's more than comfortable and she's more than happy to willing to take your help. So thank you guys again.
Worship that goddess, and for that we need some product. what God has worship product, which will cost you nearly 500. Okay, so dandy affairs. So in this picture back again, you see those ladies? Yeah, in their hand there should be a dandiya actually. So this event called Navratri with Garba, and there is another picture. So with the dandiyas in hand, you can dance a specific way. So that's something we need for that event. So that's dandiya. On addition, printing, market, and promotional items, including t-shirts, CSU, Navratri ISO t-shirts, which will cost 750, and the most important thing, mouth-watering Indian food, which will cost nearly 2,500. So our total budget is $5,000 right now, and I'm assuring you guys that this event is going to be one of the biggest cultural event of the CSU. So thank you all for listening to me. Any questions and comments?
Are you aware that you're only given $5,000 per year for your events? If finance committee correct me if I'm wrong, $5,000 per year for your events. Okay, so for this one event, ISO will have a total of $5,000. Are you aware of that?
Well.
So this one event, the entirety of the money that your organization has allocated will go to it. Are you aware of that?
Well, thank you for drawing my attention, but yeah, I know that. But this is I told you, this is one of the biggest event that Indian student organization can do. So one of the biggest event. So yeah, that's why we are proposing this. Yes, sir.
So when is this event going to be? First part.
Oh, okay. 7th November.
So. Could you, we have a funding hearing next week.
That's, I guess, where I'm confused. I thought we were under the impression that we were going to be doing no more student organizations coming to the Senate and asking for funds. We were going to utilize the Senate Funding Committee for their purpose. So I'm not, I guess, understanding why this group is presenting in front of us.
Then they should have paid the first funding.
Yeah, that's right.
So, if you would have came to the first funding hearing, you would have had the money in time for this event on November 7th. Is there a reason why you didn't request the funds?
Yeah, there is a reason. Actually, ISO being through some changes. When it was 15 days earlier, our president got admission in another university, so they have to transfer, and that's why the all that chain of that order will change. We have to appoint new president and vice president. That's why. So that's why we are running late.
My only recommendation to you, based upon our policies that we have initiated at the beginning of the year, and also the Finance Committee bylaws, which also address this issue, is that unfortunately, it's most likely you're going to have to postpone the event and request funds today, which is the deadline for the second hearing. There's really no if, ands, or buts about it, actually.
And even if you could, can someone correct me if I'm wrong, last year we said that if they came to the Senate meeting asking for money that they would not get all that they requested. It was set numbers, is that true? So you would only be able to get 25.
The document you're referring to was an amendment to the Finance Committee bylaws, and those were never actually passed again.
Even last year?
We talked about it, but if you look at the Finance bylaws right now, they're not. Vice President.
I I recommend that we continue to follow the policies that we initiated at the beginning of the year, which is fair to all orgs, because you know you set these rules aside, it's fair to every org. It's no longer favoritism to one or the other. Unfortunately, we have 4 finance hearings. The only people who were allowed at the beginning of the year to request funds at the Senate meeting were people whose events were before the first hearing. So therefore, they couldn't go to a hearing. In your case, you could have went to the first hearing and had the money in time for this event. Regardless of whatever internal struggles were happening, unfortunately, my recommendation to the Senate would be to follow the rules and regulations that we agreed upon at the beginning of the year, which is fair to all and everybody involved.
I'm aware of that, that they had one person in the executive board of ISO who is the president right now, and he was in the executive board for the past 2 months, so he could have done that if he had.
Would you be willing to
move
to
the
Yeah, for that, good point. So for moving that event behind the timeline, I mean, it's already late according to that. For that festival, it should be in specific month according to that beliefs related with that. So actually, we are already running 15 days or 20 days late for that festival. But if we do a little bit more late, then it doesn't make sense. I mean,
so can you take it to the next marketing hearing? Request that
funding
then, and then it will be deliberated by finance committee.
Would
you be able to do that?
Interesting. So the money will be transferred to the account sale from
birth after November 11th.
November 11th?
So the latest you can have your event is November 11th or after that.
Let's keep that in mind.
$5,000 in one event, so you're not going to have an event anymore.
Sorry to take it off some of your questions, but let's decide whether or not we actually plan on funding this for innovation. So, I suppose we need to do more to add to your
point. I mean, I'm sure the event would be great, and it's too bad that you guys weren't able to do it in time, but it is the policy, it's the policy. You know, I mean, it's the only way to be fair to every student org. You know, we only have a certain amount of money, all these things are put in place for fairness and equity. So I recommend that we vote to not approve the funding for this event. And I recommend to the student org that came here today to put in a request for funding today, which is the deadline. So if it's still open, I recommend you put this up there. If you don't want to do the event, you know, because it's going to be late, that's your own prerogative. But it has to be done by today is the deadline. So that's all I have to say about it.
I was just gonna, you know, echo Vice President Wilson, because the whole point of having the Finance Committee is to do these deliberations so this meeting doesn't go long, so we don't have 10 organizations coming and we're doing double duty. So at this point in time, instead of continuing to talk about the event, I would decide if you're going to actually talk about it here, or if you're going to follow the recommendation and have them fill out their application through the Finance Committee.
Would anyone like to entertain a motion?
I entertain a motion to allocate
$5,000 from whatever, from the discretion, the discretion fund towards the ISO's.
I think what was being recommended, though, was whether you were going to talk about this event or not, not if you were, what you were doing.
Well, aren't they asking for funding?
Right, so are we going to entertain that, or are we going to recommend that they go to the finance committee?
Well, I mean, what Christine, or Senator Tsai, does have the power to do, so basically, she's asking for is that we do entertain this request, and then we go from there. So I think that's what we
yeah.
were
okay.
trying
to decide.
So we vote on their decision,
okay.
that's all I was saying.
I think
okay.
now is the point we, where the Senate can have a discussion about whether or not we fund this or that. It's coming out of the discretionary budget. We only have, according to this, we only have $4,000. So that's going to come from the finance committee, but if we decide to take that money.
Okay.
Okay,
so any other discussion? Any objections?
So clarification, please don't be talking. Clarification, yes is to object to the funding, correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, to object to the funding, no is to not object to the funding. The results are 16 for the objection, so won't be funding. ISO today. Is there any other further discussion on the matter?
Personally, I will speak for myself and say that I apologize that I voted against. I think that it's really unfortunate situation. I think the event itself is valid, but I feel also that it's important to be consistent, and therefore that's why we denied. However, I would encourage the use of your application so that you can get funding if you want to do it later or in the future, you know, work with us ahead of time.
Yeah, I
was
just going on what
you
said. You know, this doesn't mean that you don't get to do your event. You can still do it. You just have to do it within our guidelines and our policies. We have to be an institution of transparency and accountability, and to do that, we have to live on our policies. So I think going on what you said is the next one event. We should do that. We need to go to the funding area and request funding, just as every organization does, to be fair to all
organizations. And I recommend you to, before you go to finance, do anything like talk to any executive board or anybody related to finance, because I see a lot of expenses that can be funded with SGA funding, so please go over and let it go.
Then, if we are not passing this right now, then I would like to do it early as possible, so I would ask for the treasurer's advice for that.
Okay, he comes to the finance, he comes to the second day, this is next Friday.
This Friday?
Just put a request on it.
No, I'll go draw it.
There is a deadline for 5 o'clock for
So is that okay? I mean, yeah. I do after this meeting?
That's okay, but after this meeting.
So, if there's nothing else to say, we can turn to the president.
All right, thank you very much, guys.
Dr. Yarbrough asked that I present this to you all. I know it's last minute. He gave it to me about a half hour ago. So if you want to take one and pass it along. Also, where are we at with that sign-in sheet that I got for the lunch? We're still circulating that.
No, it's
done. Oh, it's done. Awesome. I'll grab that one. You wouldn't mind starting to fill up the front part, the first part. I think it's all information that you can add right now without looking at the slides. Thank you. slides that I'm going to show you, and they both have different setups. And I'm going to ask you what unit appeals to you most. So this is Unit A, which has a community bath and would house two students. This is B, which is two students which would share that space. C, three bedrooms, three baths. D, shared bed and bath. E, private bed and shared bath, four students per unit. So you have to decide between those that I just showed you, which one appealed to you most. Do you want me to go through them again?
Yes.
Okay. So A, two bedrooms, two baths, two students per unit. Each student has a private bed and bath. B, two bedrooms, one bath, two students per unit, private bedroom and shared bath. C, three bedrooms, three baths, six students per unit, shared bed and shared bath. D, two bedrooms, two baths, five students per unit, shared bed, shared bath. E, four students per unit, private bed, but shared bath. So you guys got all that? Select which one appealed to you most. So now based off of that, which unit based on price? So unit A is least expensive, unit B is most expensive. So would you change your answer? Which one appealed to you if A was the least expensive and B was the most? Or you can still stick with what you selected.
Don't cross it out. There's one that's missing. Unit A is a one bedroom and it's a community bath. So two students, like a traditional college dorm, whatever, you know, you think like OU or OSU. So one bedroom, community bath, and that's two students. You can see that on the paper, but then you cannot see it on the slide. Everyone read?
So then unit B, which is two students, would correspond with this unit A that we have on the show.
So this would be unit A.
Does that make sense?
This would be unit B.
So this is B. So everything kind of jumped a letter forward. Does that make sense? And A is the one that now is explained. I know I was given this. Sorry, guys.
So you can't see A, okay? A right here would be considered B, okay? So we'll go through one more time.
So A is the one that's not on your sheet. Not on the slideshow. A is not on the slideshow. A is not on the slideshow. It's how Malik explained it, traditional. So you have a community bath, there's two students sharing space. B is right here. disregard the label. This is B, actually. This is opposite day. So this is B, two bedrooms, two baths. This is C, two bedrooms, one bath. This is D. This is E. And this is F, of course. So does that make sense now? Yes? Were you able to fill out 17 and 18? Yes? Perfect.
So pick which one most, that's for 17. Which one most appeals to you? So now that you know what the layouts look at, knowing that unit A is the least expensive, and then unit D is the second least expensive, in that order, and unit B is the most expensive, then where is your preference?
Does it change your preference?
Knowing pricing. Does everyone
read? You guys all pass that question?
Awesome, this is great.
You got 18.
Yeah. This is perfect. We're knocking it out of the park on this Friday.
Did your answers change potentially?
Of course.
Raise your hands. No.
They did change.
So then 19, then 19 you can answer without these beautiful slides. What is the most you can spend per month for housing? And then you can select for 20 what would make on-campus housing appeal to you. So maybe for you, it's in-suite laundry. Maybe you need a private bathroom because you don't trust a nasty neighbor. Yes.
Okay, so I have a question. Is this for like some apartments or some dorms?
Dorms.
Okay.
Maybe you want a fitness facility, a fitness center right there in your residence hall.
And select more than one.
Maybe you don't want to have a CSU meal plan. 21, what amenities are most important to you? Maybe you want to have a cat. Maybe you like a coffee bar. I don't know why I told you to read some of these. And then 22, will you live in new on-campus housing in 2018? I know. And then I would not move into new student housing in 2018 and because. Is that any additional comments? So I thank you for filling this out and bearing with me as we had to switch some slides around. So if we could collect these, that would be wonderful. And then I'll also collect the sign-up sheet for the lunch. Thank you for bearing with me on the slideshow. A few more things from my end. I am really looking forward to tomorrow's retreat. Please plan on being there. Please plan on being at the Park for Make a Difference Day. We have some community partners that are looking forward to having us. We signed up for at least 25 people to be at our location for Make a Difference Day. I worked it out with our community affiliate to have our own location. So it's going to be awesome. So make sure you're there in the atrium at 8 o'clock. Check in and go over as a group together, or make sure you let Malik know that you'll be meeting us at the location at 9 o'clock. And then, of course, the retreat taking place at Mather, which is going to be a lot of fun. I look forward to getting to know you guys a little bit more. I feel like sometimes we're just kind of ships passing by one another, and you say hello to me, and in my head I'm trying to gather your name, and I'm terrible at names, so I'm always like, hey, you! So I look forward to getting to know you better. So thank you so much.
Real quickly, the discussion that took place about the funding, that's the most effective and the most democratic process to handle a situation like that. In the past, we've been kind of inefficient about it. The way that we just handled it is the most efficient and fair process, so I commend all of you for good discussion and good process.
Make sure you guys put in a funding request.
Yeah.
And also talk to us. Come to the office if you need to, and we'll explain to you like all the the nuances, like how to make sure that you get funding, you know, so that way this never happens again to you guys. Because I am sorry, you know, I don't ever like to see that, so I just want to make sure that's known.
So other than that, just a reminder, submit your office hours type of you're supposed to be 9 to 5, so if you guys tell me if you completed that math interview, I'll know something wrong. So let's do that, and then I'll have done at the end of the day today. Keep in mind that that goes to your scholarship criteria. If you're not there tomorrow, that also will deduct money for your scholarship. So be there. Anyway, so moving on, I adjourned this meeting at 5:07.
So now that I'm your director of policy and procedures, you guys, so the committee heads come up with an application on how to conduct committee meetings, you know, in terms of keeping the meeting minutes and how to conduct those. Also, the office came up with recommending for that. I'll be here and assist to the secretary, Fresh, and Peter Kagan. So if you guys introduce them, then I'll be a second contact for that. Also, if you guys have any questions about the voting center duties, I'm also going to be looking for that. I'm basically making a reference to the Constitution and House manual. So bother me as much as you like it. Just, if you guys really are bothering me, I fully enjoy it. So.